Hey YouTube, welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be going through some things that I bought and also some things that I've been wearing in the months of February and March. We're going to go through quite a few things today. I'm going to try to keep it as concise as possible, but if you're interested in hearing, stick around. Okay, I'm going to start with this little bottle right here because it is my scent of the evening. This is Coccobello by Heeley. This is a fragrance that I got as part of the Heeley Discovery Kit. They come in these 15ml bottles, which are just fantastic. They're very much like a miniature of the real bottles, but they're heavy. They have an excellent sprayer on the top. And the packaging is very nice. As for the fragrance, Coccobello is described as being a kind of a beachy scent. It's got a coconut note that's prominent right up front. But to me, that's not really what I like it for. I don't find it to be particularly beachy or gourmand. To me, this fragrance is all about the dry down. In the dry down, there's the most irresistible, to me at least, scent of sandalwood and benzoin. It starts off as a slightly salty, tropical, a little bit watery coconut, but not very sweet at all. And in the heart, there's a little bit of a white floral gardenia kind of deal. But the base is just an absolutely delectable sandalwood, lactonic, spicy benzoin thing. And I have been really, really enjoying this one. It wasn't one of the standouts for me in the Discovery Kit when I first ordered it, but over time I've come to really like it, and I'm now considering getting a full bottle. Okay, the next one that I'll talk about is very similar to Heeley's Coccobello. This is Prada's Infusion de Ylang. This is the newest addition to the Prada Infusions line, along with Infusion de Veni. I think these are both 2022 releases. Anyway, Infusion de Ylang is a sort of tropical fragrance, as you might expect from the Ylang Ylang. But to me, this has a very, very similar progression as the Coccobello, where it starts off with a creamy Ylang up top. This time it's joined by a really powerful and smooth cardamom, which makes it much more masculine than I would have expected. And then it dries down to a very similar benzoin sandalwood base. If I were trying to decide between these two fragrances, Coccobello and Infusion de Ylang, I think I'd probably go with Coccobello because right now they're the same price. And I'm just kind of a Heeley fanboy at this point. But this is a wonderful fragrance, a really great surprise, and I'm happy that I bought a decant. I thought I would also show off the Discovery Kit that I got this month of the Prada Infusions line. I had been really curious about this line for a while. I remembered smelling the Infusion de Iris a long time ago, which is probably the flagship scent of this line. So I got this relatively inexpensively on eBay, and it's a very, very nice presentation. Can't really tell, but the boxes kind of got like a soft leathery feel. Inside, all of these are splash bottles, and they come wrapped in paper with the name of the fragrance which is inside. This kit includes vetiver, oyette, amande, fleur d'orange, iris cedra, and iris. I also bought Infusion de Ylang, as you saw just a second ago, and I also got a set of Infusion de Mimosa. Overall, I thought they were all very, very nice, very palatable scents. They all follow a very similar DNA, the Infusion de Iris DNA, which is kind of a soapy, slightly powdery, but not too powdery, cedar, benzoin, sandalwood kind of deal. So they're all very soft, they're all very pretty, and all very polite, but none of them really made my heart swoon, except for, to some extent, Infusion de Ylang. But I was happy to get to try them all out and happy that I can have them on hand to sniff from time to time. All right, next up. About a month and a half ago, I got a discovery set from Les Indemodables. I was really interested in this house, and this has been by far one of the most fun discovery sets that I've ever tried. I believe it came with 12 scents. There's 10 fragrances that the house has as staples and then two colognes. And I've made a few selections so far of things that I wanted to add permanently. So the big bottle you see before you is Escale in Indonesie. which I believe translates to layover or weekend in Indonesia. This is an ambergris fragrance, which I didn't like very much when I first tried it. It's got a very sharp citrusy opening, and it's very salty in the dry down. But over the course of wearing my sample, I became increasingly intrigued by it. I thought it would be a great summer fragrance, and importantly, it's pretty inexpensive at $120 for 100ml. So I picked it up, and I've been really happy with it so far. You can see I've put a little bit of a dent in it. It is a great fragrance for when you don't want to wear something too heavy, because it kind of lays low for the first couple of hours, but has a really beautiful, soft, salty, ozonic dry down. That being said, this bottle, which I've had since early February, has now got some space in it and is, I guess the word is macerated a little bit. And it has become much, much, much more powerful. The juice has gotten a lot darker. I actually wore it yesterday and did my normal kind of four sprays. And eventually I had to take a shower because it was really blasting off my skin. And when I read the materials for the Les Indemodables, it looks like they only age their fragrances after manufacture for about a month before they're shipped off to retailers. So this might be just a thing that happens with all of them. I don't know. But it's a wonderful fragrance. I also picked up, these are 10ml decants. This one is Iris Pearl. And this is a really beautiful iris fragrance, but even more than iris, I'd say it's a mimosa and ylang ylang fragrance with a beautiful, salty, clary sage marine element. It's kind of hard to describe, but it's very pretty. And the next one is Cuir de Chine by Les Indemodables. And this is an osmanthus-based fragrance, but it also has jasmine, tobacco, clary sage. It's leathery, but not too leathery. I'm not a huge fan of leathery scents. To me, it's really kind of an unusual green osmanthus fragrance. And I'm very happy to have decants with these because they're both incredibly well-made fragrances, but I find that I haven't been reaching for them all that often, and these two fragrances, or the fragrances from Les Indemodables that are not the colognes, are actually quite expensive. So I'm happy that I got the 10 mil to try to burn through before I make a decision on any other ones. Over on the right, these are some of the samples that remain. I've used up some of them in their entirety, like Escale in Haiti, which is the vetiver cologne, which I really, really like, and I think I will get a bottle of. The other ones that were highlights from the collection, Oriental Velours, that was a lovely myrrh fragrance. I really enjoyed that one. Probably not enough to pick it up. Rose du Jamal, I like mostly any rose fragrance. This one, I wasn't inclined to pick this one up. It's very masculine. It's got mint and cedar. And in fact, I think all of the Les Indemodables fragrances lean masculine, even though it's created by a husband and wife team. They all have a distinctly kind of male bent to me. And that's not a bad thing. It's just something that's I'm aware of. Anyway, that was, again, a very fun discovery set and one full bottle from Les Indemodables. All right, next up is kind of a different direction. These are two fragrances that I've worn the most often to the office in February and March. It has been an unusually cold and wet February and March here in Los Angeles with an unbelievable amount of rain, and these two scents have been perfect for a cold, wet California winter. Hippie Rose, I talked about in my last video, actually, it was a new pickup then. I have been wearing this nonstop to the office. It is kind of becoming a signature scent for me. I'm surprised the dent from this angle doesn't look bigger because I have worn it a lot. It lasts all day long. It smells very elegant and very comforting at the same time. I'm just over the moon with it. Gray flannel is a classic, which gets a lot of hype and kind of fragrance community online, but it is for a good reason. It's a gorgeous fougere. Got somewhat of a challenging opening. I like the opening, but other people may not. The opening does stay around for a little bit as well, but the heart is an incredible floral bouquet with mimosa and narcissus, rose, sage. And the base is a really beautiful lavender tonka kumarin thing. So these two have been getting a lot of play lately at the office in particular. Hippie Rose by Heeley and Grey Flannel by Geoffrey Beene. All right, next up is Ganymede by Marc-Antoine-Barrois. This is a fragrance which at this point probably needs no introduction, but it is a much hyped leather fragrance by what I suppose Marc-Antoine-Barrois is a French couturier. And this fragrance has kind of become famous for how unusual it is, and I will give it that. It doesn't really smell like anything I've smelled before. The first few times I smelled it, I thought it smelled exactly like a glossy magazine, like kind of when you get it in the mail and you can dig your face into the crease, and it has that plasticky, ozonic, mineral smell. The more I wear it, though, it is very heavy, very dark, very, I don't want to say sweet, but it is definitely kind of a niche club scent. The reason I put it here is it's not a new purchase for me. I've had it for quite some time and just haven't worn it very much. But I had a friend visiting from New York who came, and he sampled it, and it kind of blew him away because it's such a strong fragrance. It lasts forever. When I want to wear this, I really have to kind of look at the calendar and see what I have going on a few days after, because this thing will not come off. It's incredibly loud, persistent. The dry down is beautiful, but it will not go away. So you really have to think about if you want to wear this or not. That being said, I'm really happy to have it in my collection because it is interesting. It does fill a specific niche for kind of a nighttime going out scent, even though I don't do that very much. And my friend who was visiting from New York kind of made me see it in a different light, because I think that if I were still living in New York, where I lived for 7 or 8 years in my 20s, this would be a very appropriate fragrance there, because it does beautifully in cold temperatures. It's very seductive and lively and nighttime, which, at least for me, is a vibe that's very specific to New York City in a way that it is not to Los Angeles. Anyway, that is a lot about Ganymede. In the same breath, I wanted to mention a fragrance that I find to be, fill a slightly similar niche, but is more in my style, probably. This is Cartier's La Treizieme Heure, the 13th Hour. This is from the Les Heures collection by Cartier, designed by Mathilde Laurent. This is just a stunning scent. I can't get enough of it. I think it's beautiful. I don't think enough people talk about it. It is, to me, primarily a patchouli and vanilla scent, although I know a lot of people see it as being a leather, kind of smoky scent. To me, it's almost a gourmand. I think it's delicious. It's super comforting. It's very nighttime. It's also a little seductive. I think the feeling that it gives me is kind of a autumn time or Halloween time feeling, where it's nighttime and the air is crisp, and maybe there's some smoke from a chimney stack somewhere in the atmosphere. And I mean, this is oddly specific, but you're on a hayride in a leather jacket and jeans next to somebody that you're really into, and they're eating a candied apple. So it's very specific, but it is wonderful. I am really tempted to buy a full bottle of this, but it is incredibly expensive. I think it's $280, and the bottle is 75 mils. It's not even 100 mil. I'd also like to try Le Labo's Patchouli 24 before making that decision, because Le Labo's Patchouli 24 is said to be extremely similar to this, and on a per mil basis, believe it or not, is actually cheaper. Anyway, two nighttime fragrances. That's Cartier's Le Treizieme Heure and Ganymede by Marc-Antoine-Barrois. All right, so I said we were going through a lot of things today, and I was not lying. This is a set of samples that I bought at Le Labo. Le Labo is a house that I have kind of avoided, if I'm honest, because of A, the aesthetic doesn't really appeal to me. It's kind of like a weird early 2000 teens steampunk restoration hardware vibe, which really wasn't up my alley. And B, the prices. The prices on their fragrances are ridiculous. And they actually have a line of city exclusives, which are only available in, the city that you're visiting, which are even more ridiculously, absurdly priced. So I'd avoided them for a long time, but I'd started seeing some suggestions for a lot of the fragrances that I was looking at that where there are some that are gems, it seems. And so I ventured out to the Le Labo boutique in West Hollywood. They don't give out samples. You have to buy them. They are expensive. I think it was $8 a sample at the West Hollywood Le Labo. And for the city exclusives, I got the city exclusive for Los Angeles, which is Musk 25. That was actually $13. So it was a lot of money to spend on samples, but it was actually money well spent. I liked many of them. And I think I will actually go back and purchase the full discovery set at some point. I can talk a little bit about the ones that I've sampled already. Labdanum 18 is a Maurice Roussel creation. He is famous for creating Musc Ravageur for Frederick Malle. Labdanum 18 is a very nice scent. I thought it was kind of like a brown, fuzzy, masculine baby powder scent. It's very nice. It's musky. It didn't really do anything for me, though. What did was the next one, which was Ylang 49, a beautiful Chypre scent. It starts off with a blast of the most beautiful patchouli with that Ylang up top that smells unusual and seductive and just gorgeous, very old Hollywood. As it dries down, it becomes slightly more floral, which I at first I didn't really like, but overall, the projection, sillage, the uniqueness of this scent is breathtaking. And I have been going back and forth as to whether or not I need a bottle. It actually does remind me a lot of something I already have, though, which is Johnny Versace's original Versace EDT, which is a 1981 Chypre, the first scent that Versace released. I have that, and it is also incredible. So I may hang back and not buy Ylang 49 just yet. The next one is Rose 31, which is supposed to be kind of famously a dirty, very dirty rose with cumin and guaiac. I've loved this one, actually. It is not a rose dominant fragrance, in my opinion. It is a vetiver, cedar, guaiac dominant, very woody. Very spicy, a little bit incense-y, with just a very pretty pink rose somewhere in there. I love it, frankly, and I think I might end up getting it someday. I would get it right away if not for the price. I think the full-size 100 ml bottles of Le Labo in the Classic Collection currently retail for $320, so they're very pricey. Next up is Musk 25, which is the Los Angeles exclusive. This is very pretty. It reminds me of Kiehl's original Musk. It does have more interest than that. I can tell that it would have very pretty sillage, but the price is a non-starter. I think the city exclusives for the 100 ml bottles are now something like $480, and that is absolutely abhorrent for what is effectively just a very pretty musk scent. And the last one here is Santal 33, which is the only one I really didn't care for. I mean, it's not unfair to say it because everybody thinks this, or a lot of people think this, but it smelled to me of dill pickles. I didn't even try it on skin. Anyway, that is my discoveries from Le Labo. Okay, and finally, the last one I'll talk about today is another new pickup for me. I got this early in February. This is Rose de Taif by Perris Monte Carlo. You guys know that I've been on a rose kick. This is a very unique, wonderful, Eastern-inspired rose. Taif is a highland city in Saudi Arabia that's at something like 6,000 feet elevation. It's famed for its roses, which grow there. This perfume, which is a Luca Maffei creation for Paris Monte Carlo, is a rose-dominant fragrance, certainly, but there's also a lot of geranium at the top. There's a lot of lemon. There's also a nutmeg accord in here, which is a spice which I think it leans kind of citrusy in and of itself. All of these things combine to make a rose that is kind of like acid pink. It's very loud. It's a little bit fruity from that citrus. It's, gosh, it's just really, really good. I can't wait for it to get even warmer because this is the kind of rose that would just shine in hot weather. I think it's 100% unisex. I think it's enchanting. I think it's pink and frothy and electric and very unlike many roses that you smell on the market today. It was also not a very expensive fragrance to pick up. I think I paid $89 for this bottle, and I will get a lot of wear out of it. The only other thing that I think is worth mentioning about this fragrance is that it is very intense up front, but a thing that I find fascinating about it is it's a long-lasting fragrance, and it has a lot of sillage and projection, but throughout the course of a day, it winds down in a way that it dries down to a kind of wispy pink musk on the skin, which is only faintly rosy and barely there. And I heard somebody describe Middle Eastern perfumery in general as having kind of a reverse pyramid, where the top is very in your face and sometimes difficult, but as things dry down, they become very dry and kind of float away. That the perfume, instead of getting heavier, as many Western perfumes do in the dry down, these become more ephemeral. And that does this beautifully. I am incredibly happy to have it. And I'm incredibly happy that you guys stuck with me through this whole video. So thank you for watching, and I hope I'll see you again soon. Bye.